Good afternoon. I'm Stephanie Shearholtz from NASA's Office of Communications. We're here at the Kennedy Space Center today to talk with scientists and researchers about the important studies they will be conducting in microgravity. It's a good day to be talking about space exploration and advancements in science. Today is the 54th anniversary of Yuri Gagarin's launch and the 34th anniversary of the first space shuttle launch. Tomorrow at 4:33 p.m. Eastern Time, SpaceX will launch its sixth commercial resupply services mission to the International Space Station. Here today to talk with us about some of the approximately 40 science investigations directly supported by this launch are Dr. Marshall Porterfield, Division Director, Space, Life, and Physical Sciences, NASA's Human Exploration and Operations Mission Directorate at NASA Headquarters, Dr. Kirt Costello, International Space Station Deputy Chief Scientists at NASA's Johnson Space Center, Dr. Noel Clark, Professor of Physics at the University of Colorado Boulder and Principal Investigator for the OASIS investigation, and Dr. Paola D, Associate Professor of Molecular and Cell Biology at the Goldman School of Dental Medicine at Boston University, and the Director of the Bone Cell Core at Massachusetts General Hospital. She's the Principal Investigator for Osteo4 investigation. Our intent today is to enable discussion, so we'll take questions throughout our talk. If you would like to ask a question, please raise your hand. Dr. Porterfield, can you start us off by telling us a little bit about some of the studies NASA's Space, Life, and Physical Sciences Division has flying on this mission?
Yeah, we're currently sponsoring seven payloads, scientific payloads, that will be launched on this resupply mission. We're really excited about this. Three of these are related to the Human Research Program. One experiment's focusing on intracranial pressure and visual impairment, fluid shifts experiment. We also have studies looking at diurnal cycle and the interaction between light and gravity and sleep quality in the crew. And we're also resupplying necessities needed to conduct a twin study, working with Scott and Mark Kelly, who are twin pairs on a study that allows us to look at an astronaut in microgravity and his genetic twin on the ground over a year-long period. We also have two experiments in the physical sciences area, the ACE H1 payload, and also the OASIS experiment. Both of these are fluids and material science research projects, and we'll hear from Dr. Clark later about his experiment. He'll go in detail. We also have two life sciences experiments. One of them is involved with a microbial observatory initiative that we've developed out at headquarters over the last 2 years, and allows us to look at microbes and how they respond to microgravity, and how are they evolving, how are they adapting to the stress of the microgravity environment, and it's part of the environment, as part of the environment of the ISS. And the other is the BRIC 21 experiment, which actually is culturing bacteria that we will look at how they respond to the stress of the spaceflight environment, and look at how they respond to, how they become resistant to antibiotics in microgravity.
So you mentioned Scott Kelly and the twin study.
Yes.
How does studying Scott for a year in space help us with space exploration and future space exploration?
Well, I was lucky enough just a couple weeks ago to be at the launch in Baikonur, and I got to spend some time with Mark, his brother, who is the one gravity control. And this is very important in two ways. One of them is because of the fact that we have genetically paired subjects, and the integration of the 10 investigations at the systems biology level. We've really never attempted to do human research at this type of level of biotechnology. And the other part of it is the duration, because it is a one-year experiment. It's allowing us to make a leap from 6 months, which is our typical crew time on the ISS, to a year, and project out to what we will need to do to protect humans as we explore over longer periods of time, perhaps a mission to Mars over multi-years.
So we'll take some questions from the group. Ken, I think you had a question?
Yes.
Hi, Ken Kramer for America Space and Universe Today. Talk a little bit more specifically about what experiments are actually going up on this mission for the twin study, please, in some detail. Thanks.
There's Working with the Human Research Program in the NASA Space Biomedical Research Institute at Johnson Space Center, we solicited for individual proposals, but when they came in, we saw how we could integrate them into a larger study. So some of the proposals are actually looking at transcriptomic level changes. So looking at from the genome flows information, biological information, as genes are transcribed into proteins ultimately or into messages. So we now have the technology to look at all those messages. So there's somewhere around 30,000 genes to make up that make up the human genome, that are part of the human genome. And we can actually follow all of those. So some of those are transcriptomics. Some of those are really using omics technologies to look at the human microbiome. So there's our body of knowledge in terms of how we are dependent upon our symbiotic relationship with the microbes that live in and on us is continuing to expand and have huge health implications that touch everyone's life. But so we're doing those types of studies with the twins to look at how does that shift it associated with the stress of the microgravity environment. So in addition to these integrated omics approaches, which are allowing us to look at human subjects at the systems biology level for the first time, we're also doing some physiological studies. For example, we're looking at mental awareness and mental performance and how that may be changing in microgravity.
And in terms of payloads on this mission, fluid shifts is directly supported with payload on that's launching tomorrow, is that correct?
Yes, looking at human subjects in terms of the overall architecture of our bodies, how they change in the microgravity environment. Fluid shift, we've known for years that astronauts get puffy in microgravity because the fluids shift up from your feet up to your head. And that recently we've been able to document how that is associated with increasing intracranial pressure, which may be changing the shape of the eye and causing visual impairment. We need to get a handle on those types of problems now so that we don't, so that we can protect the crew in the future, because that's directly needed in terms of crew performance, our ability to see.
Another question here.
Hi, Val Phillips, Zero G News. Obviously, the twins, well, the 1 year of Scott Kelly and his Russian counterpart is the first time Americans have done a year in space. But obviously, the Russians have previously done it with Mir. Is there anything that came up from these Mir experiments that has triggered a further investigation within this new 1 year period?
Well, I think the Russian scientists learned a lot during those times. We worked directly with the Institute for Medical and Biological Problems in Moscow in coordinating these studies. So the years of experience that the Russians have developed in terms of supporting medical operations and medical research extending into these extreme long periods of time that were studied in Mir did come to play in terms of organizing our joint studies associated with the 1 year mission, looking at the Russian crew member and the American crew member. A lot of that was coordinated, was led by a multilateral research integration board that was co-led by the Institute for Medical and Biological Problems in Moscow and the Human Research Program at Johnson Space Center. And that was the coordinating board where we were able to bring in the expertise of the Russians and make sure that we're really approaching these studies in the most state-of-the-art way.
Another question here?
Joshua Evans with NASA Social. Is there a psychological component to the experimentations that will be taking place in the twin study on the ISS in terms of prolonged time in space flight, differences between Mr. Kelly on Earth and Mr. Kelly on the ISS?
Yeah, that's always an important consideration if you look at crew health and crew performance, is how do you deal with confinement, isolation, those sorts of issues. So that's part of our normal medical operations and crew support operations, but there are some aspects of the twin study that'll take that into consideration.
Thank you. Hi, James in Florida today, and just curious, based on everything you studied so far, with respect to the intracranial pressure, what are some of the things you think can be done to to mitigate that, because, you know, presumably you can't, you know, change the fluids rising and making heads puffier and all that. So are there any things that you've tried so far that are helping, or what kind of ideas do you have about that?
I think one of the techniques is it's a bodysuit that applies negative pressure to the lower extremities. That's probably the one approach that's, the Russians have used this. We use this, the same approach for pilots that are doing extreme aerial maneuvers, like fighter pilots, use these suits that can apply negative pressure to kind of pull the fluids out of the head. So that's probably one of the most important approaches. But obviously, the astronauts can't be in a negative pressure suit all the time and really perform what they need to do in microgravity as a crew member. So we do need to understand the problem more. It's a little bit early to talk about countermeasures, because we do need to understand. We actually need to make the scientific connection between the intracranial pressure and visual impairment. That hasn't been done yet. So we're working towards that, understanding it scientifically and mechanistically, so then we can engineer countermeasures to, you know, potentially alleviate that.
All right, let's move on a little bit. Dr. Costello, you're responsible for the management of the ISS program scientists and for providing independent scientific advice to the International Space Station Program, NASA Research, International Space Station, National Laboratory Research, International Research Collaboration, and Scientific Communications. Why are these commercial resupply missions so important to enabling studies in microgravity?
Thank you, Stephanie. That's a great question, because, as you know, we have multiple providers who are able to launch cargo into space. Several of those are international partners and their vehicles that do so. But SpaceX is one of our key commercial partners, and they're key because they support the capability to do sortie missions. So sortie missions are missions where we have a difficult biological constraint or a temperature constraint, need to get that science on orbit, have it conducted quickly, and return those samples to the ground. Right now, SpaceX is a real only provider that can provide us that return capability.
That's great. And research conducted on the space station spans a variety of scientific disciplines, as we've started to hear already. Can you tell us about some of the disciplines that are conducting research in space?
Sure. The SpaceX 6 mission, the CRS-6 mission, is a great example of how it's bringing science to the space station that emphasizes its capability as a multidisciplinary lab. It's bringing physical sciences samples to orbit, as we heard about with OASIS for Dr. Noel Clark. That's a liquid crystal experiment. It's also providing biological samples that will be going to orbit, and biological investigations such as our Rodent Research 2 mission and the osteocytes we'll hear about later. It also enables a lot of the human research that we do on orbit by bringing up supplies and equipment to enable those studies, like the twin studies and the fluid shift studies.
And so we get this question quite a bit. How does this research in space benefit us here on Earth?
And that's another really good question, because the ISS is a very unique vehicle. It's unique in the aspect that for NASA vehicles, it really serves two purposes. It has a primary goal of being able to provide knowledge for our exploration mission, for our continued exploration of the solar system. It also, by its designation as a national laboratory, has taken on the unique challenge to provide benefits for humanity. So the national lab science that's selected is identified particularly for how study in these particular fields might be useful to develop treatments, materials, industry that will benefit life here on Earth.
Do we have any questions from the group?
Okay, Val Phillips, Zero G News. I was actually just curious, obviously the ISS has now been up there a significant period of time. Are there any experiments that have been coming through all the way through from when it was first started off as an actual research capability? Or if not, what is the longest one that's been running up there?
That's a good question. Certainly, we have been conducting experiments on board the space station since the very first expedition was aboard. And some of those longest running experiments have been human health related experiments. So in order to get the scientific power you need for a lot of these analyses, you need to have a number of subjects go through the investigation. And right now, many of our human health-related investigations, those that are there to address the risks for human spaceflight in the future, are about midway through their investigation. Some have completed, and that takes about 10 expeditions. So again, those are typically our longest-running investigations. We have some investigations going on now, like SPRINT, which is a cardiovascular investigation that has had several subjects over the course of time, and these will add two more subjects to that.
Hi, my name is Jessica from the NASA Social. Since the space shuttle program's been retired and we've been using, you know, different variety of vehicles to get up there, are we getting the same amount of payloads as we were before or more?
Also a good question. Actually, right now we're getting many more payloads than we have in the past. And that's primarily from the fact that after the space station was completed, the assembly was completed, we were able to dedicate the mission of our crew on board to performing science. So the amount of crew time available has gone up significantly and enabled us to do more science on board compared to a shuttle mission, which of course may have gone as long as 17 days, but now we're in orbit continuously.
And about how many hours a week is that?
That works out to about 35 hours a week of pure utilization time. Of course, the time the crew spends exercising and so forth isn't counted into that, but it does go into the data collection for a lot of the investigations.
So we also have with us Dr. Mike Roberts, who is here from CASIS, the Center for the Advancement of Science in Space. Can you tell us a little bit about how CASIS operates as a national laboratory?
Thanks, Stephanie. Yes, I'd like to. So CASIS is a new player to this game. CASIS is the Center for the Advancement of Science in Space, as Stephanie said, and we are a 501c3. That means we're a nonprofit company that operates through a cooperative agreement with NASA. We've been operating through that cooperative agreement going on almost 4 years now. We're in our third year of flight operations, and we call each of our years of flight operations Advancing Research Knowledge. ARC-3 is our current operation. And our mission is to support research and technology development on the International Space Station National Lab and provide that capability to new-to-space investigators and enable investigations from academic sectors, as NASA continues to do, in addition to open up new pathways for exploration, art, research, and technology development of interest to the commercial sector and other government agencies. And by other government agencies, we mean research institutions represented by the government who have interest in utilizing the unique environment of the space station. One of those investigations that will be flying on this particular mission, and you'll be hearing more about in a minute, is an investigation sponsored by the National Institutes of Health that will be flying the station. The distinction between what CASIS is doing and the market that we are growing and what NASA continues to do is that all of the research and technology development that CASIS sponsored has direct Earth benefit. So we seek to enable access to the unique environment of space to enable companies, academicians, and those at other government agencies to utilize the unique environment of space to benefit us here on Earth.
So if there's a scientist listening and wanting to know how they can conduct their research in space, how would they go about doing that?
Thanks, Stephanie. There are a variety of ways to interact with CASIS. First and foremost is to contact us directly. We have a website which is available at www.iss-casis.org, or just Google CASIS and Center for Advancement of Science in Space and you'll find us. So we support investigations through a variety of means. One pathway are through solicited investigations. Those are formal requests for proposals where we define an area of research that we believe can benefit from exposure to microgravity or the radiation environment outside a station. and we will fund those investigations to go to station. The more important pathway for the new-to-space investigators and for commercial investigators is an unsolicited pathway. And that's where at any time of the day or night, 365 days a year, you can contact CASIS with an idea where you believe that you can utilize the International Space Station National Lab to benefit your research and technology development goals. And in those types of those unsolicited proposals, we can work with you to develop not only the type of research that can be supported, we can put you in contact with implementation partners to help you develop your payload so that you can maximize your science return on board the International Space Station.
And you also work with a number of student groups, right?
That's also true. Everything that we do from a commercial or other government agency or academic sector has a STEM wrapper around it. STEM, as everyone is familiar, is science, technology, engineering, and mathematics. In addition to each of the individual PI-directed payloads, we also continue to support, in partnership with our implementation partners and other government agencies, payloads that are directed directly towards education enhancement. So for students out there, there are a variety of opportunities that we have available each year through the National Design Challenge, through other means, where students in high schools and even younger K through 12 can promote and propose science experiments that can reach the International Space Station.
That's great. Do we have any questions from those in the room?
Yes, I'm Gina with NASA Social, and I was wondering if you could give me an example of some successful scientific research that, you know, CASIS has been involved with that has benefited from the microgravity environment.
Thank you. Yeah, so on this particular investigation, we're actually sponsoring two payloads that are returning to space. One of them is a rodent research experiment. I believe that at the beginning of the conversation, Marshall mentioned the Rodent Research 1 experiment, which flew on SpaceX 4. We, on that same investigation for Rodent Research 1, sponsored a commercial investigation from Novartis, Institutes of Biomedical Research. They are now flying a second rodent research mission on SpaceX 6. So in the course of two missions, they've been able to be a repeat customer to fly that. In this particular investigation, they're going to be leveraging upon some of the same data that the twin study is seeking to develop from the crew exploration of life in space for the length of a year. The mice aren't going to stay up there for a year, but the mice are going to be able to experience microgravity for longer than 45 days in this particular experiment, which represents a significant portion of their lifespan. We also have an investigation from Merck Pharmaceutical. Merck is flying their second experiment on a protein crystal growth experiment with CASIS, and they are seeking to exploit the microgravity environment in ways that you'll hear more about in just a minute for the absence of buoyancy-driven convection in that environment. So as many of you may be familiar, protein crystal growth was a very avid area of research during the shuttle program. And the capabilities for continuing protein crystal growth experiments have expanded quite dramatically because of improvements in the hardware and the length of time that protein crystals can be formed in the microgravity environment. We're also sponsoring an investigation from a new-to-space company, an entrepreneur startup company called RAS Labs. They're interested in using the external environment of the International Space Station to determine the stability, the resistance to degradation, of an elastomer that they are going to be using in developing robotics systems.
And we'll hear more about both of those in the next panel following this one. I think there was another question here.
How have some young adults, as you've mentioned, STEM students, involved themselves in CASIS?
Very good question. So there are a variety of on-ramps to that. We sponsor, through our STEM partners, part of the National Design Challenge. So what we've been doing to date are Pathfinder programs with schools in certain areas, Colorado, Massachusetts, and Texas to date. And what we offer there are opportunities, access to the International Space Station through one of our partners. One of our partners in those investigations is NanoRacks. As many of you are familiar, NanoRacks has developed a plug-and-play platform with an identical form factor. So it enables all of the external parameters that are required for building a payload to not be of concern to the payload developer or the principal investigator who's developing the experiment. Therefore, the students and their teachers and their mentors can focus on what type of science they would like to do inside of that particular cube.
Mark Gotch, Historical Imagery, Canada. Could you tell me, mankind has benefited so many ways in terms of what the ISS has given back to mankind already. In looking forward to Orion and beyond, could you tell me what role ISS will play in Mars exploration?
I could, but it's a little outside of our focus area. With CASIS, we're focused solely on use of the International Space Station National Lab for Earth benefit, as I mentioned. So obviously, there are lots of areas of dual-use technology, as Marshall mentioned, where the types of investigations that we are interested in sponsoring that enable investigation of disease development, the onset of progression of human disease here on Earth, are identical to the concerns that are experienced by NASA Human Research Program in seeking to go beyond low Earth orbit.
And yeah, Dr. Porterfield, you can weigh in a little bit.
Yeah, I'd be happy to address that. The science that NASA itself is sponsoring is really focused on using the ISS as a laboratory. We follow our marching orders from Congress and the National Academy of Sciences through a National Research Council decadal survey, which basically is a inventory of the science that needs to be accomplished. So we are focused on using the International Space Station to develop the science that's needed to advance human exploration out beyond low Earth orbit. That includes the human system and the biomedical operations, biomedical research and the human research program, but also in the physical sciences program, developing new materials and capabilities like advanced cryogenic storage, which could improve our ability to store propellants for long duration missions for Mars mission or an asteroid retrieval mission. So yes, we're very focused on that in terms of what we're doing from the NASA side and the space life and physical sciences research program.
And technology demonstrations as well. You may have seen the video earlier this week of the first 3D printed parts that were returned from the space station, and those will be tested against an identical set of parts that were on the ground to see what the differences are. Question here?
Yes, I'm Christian Kiske with NASA Social. So presumably there are a lot more organizations and groups that want to do science on the ISS than you have the capability of doing the science on the ISS. What are the criteria that you use to decide which experiments get done?
That's an excellent question. So one of the ways that NASA works with CASIS through the cooperative agreement to sort of prime that pump is NASA has provided to CASIS half of the upmass that's going to the International Space Station National Lab on the operating segment. So we have a considerably great bandwidth in order to support experiments going to station. We also have access to half of the crew time that's going to be devoted to science research on board station. We have now already reached a point where we're starting to fill those pathways up because there is significant commercial interest as well as building interest from other government agencies that have worked with NASA previously to utilize that International Space Station as a unique environment. So the way that CASIS prioritizes the research that's selected is based on a defined review process that the entire process is transparent. It's available on our website. But each of the investigations that we support, whether they're unsolicited or through the solicited pathway, have to pass through a formal review process that includes both an operational feasibility review as well as a technical review based on scientific merit. And for that scientific merit review, we, like NASA, utilize external panels of subject matter experts in that area. Since one of our goals at CASIS is to increase the return on investment that we as U.S. taxpayers have made in the station, we also have an economic review component that proposals have to go through. And that can be used as a metric both for tangible return on investment, where there's a product or an improvement in a level of technology that can be returned. It can also include intangible benefit, where there is significant potential for discovery, even at a fundamental level, that can lead to additional discoveries later on. And all of those review criteria are viewed at through the lens, again, of having Earth benefit. So as Marshall pointed out, NASA continues to fund fundamental investigation in space, life, and physical sciences. They also continue to support exploration-related research. Our research portfolio at CASIS, again, is focused entirely on research and technology development that can benefit humanity here on Earth.
Hi, Enzo Vito with NASA Social and Embry-Riddle Prescott. Orbital Sciences is the other commercial resupply contractor. Are there differences between the Orbital Science vehicle and the SpaceX vehicle that can better suit CASIS payloads?
Well, yeah, I can answer briefly and then Kirt can jump in. The primary one is science return. A lot of the investigations that CASIS has supported, we support both physical sciences and life sciences experiments. And from the commercial sector and many of the other government agency sectors, there's a premium on return of the payload to you. And the only vehicle that can currently do that is the SpaceX vehicle. So for vehicles that have needs for sample return in addition to data, that's our ride up and our ride down. Orbital offers some unique capabilities, though, in that there's the trunk that's available for outside investigations. And there are, I think, some features coming up on the when Orbital returns to flight that will be of significant advantage to some of our customers as well.
That's a good point, Mike. I think the other thing to point out between the two commercial providers is the SpaceX system, the Dragon capsule, has developed an environmental control system. So that's what enables our capability to fly live samples to space, particularly rodents. And then Orbital itself has a large cargo capacity. So some of our particularly heavy payloads fit well into the Orbital vehicle as opposed to the Dragon.
Was there another question in the back?
Social. A lot of the experiments that we've been discussing touch on human physiology and pathology, but I was wondering whether or not any of the ISS experiments focus on climate change or the sustainability of Earth's resources in regards to the betterment of humanity.
From CASIS' perspective, we don't currently have any on this next SpaceX mission, but we have supported use of the International Space Station as a remote sensing platform. So we have supported investigations that use data from the HICO sensor, for example, as well as other imaging capabilities where the International Space Station can essentially be used as a satellite bus that's looking back at the Earth from different vantage points every day. So on this current mission, no, we don't have anything that's of a remote sensing capability, but we have in the past, and we have some other projects that are in development that will utilize that capability soon.
And the fourth SpaceX commercial resupply services mission delivered the ISS RapidSCAT payload, which is a remote Earth sensing investigation as well. Let's move on. We have Dr. Clark here to talk to us about his investigation called OASIS. He's from the University of Colorado Boulder. Your study is looking at how liquid crystals, such as those in display screens, which probably most people are watching us on, behave in microgravity. Can you tell us a little bit about liquid crystals and why microgravity is a good place to study them?
Sure, Stephanie, thanks. Our project is a collaboration between our group in Boulder and a group at the University of Magdeburg in Germany and a group at the Russian Academy of Sciences. Liquid crystals are a class of materials that have properties in between fluids and solids. So in these displays, for example, solids have a optical property called birefringence, and in solids it's kind of a fixed quantity. In liquid crystals, since they're liquids, you can manipulate it, and being able to manipulate it enables you to make a display. So when I was starting out in the liquid crystal business, kind of one of the holy grails was to make displays. And over that time, the field managed to achieve this with, of course, a lot of technology development and development of electronics. But another part of this is a real sort of blossoming of basic science of of liquid crystals, really understanding how this combination of fluids and solids actually works. So OASIS is an experiment in sort of this spirit, understanding basic liquid crystal physics and using microgravity, using the sort of the unique properties of microgravity to you know, to do experiments that are otherwise not possible. I can, let's see, I have a couple of slides here, if I could.
Do you want the slide or the video?
I think the slide. Okay, so what we're going to be doing is making bubbles in space. So you can think of, soap bubbles. So the drawing on the top is a cross section of a soap bubble on a frame. You know, soap is a mixture. A soap bubble is a mixture of soap and water. So in a soap bubble, the water is makes a thin film. The water is on the inside. The soap is on the surface, making it stable. Now, if you make a soap bubble, you know that they have these very nice colors, and the colors are coming from the fact that the bubble can change thickness. So the water flows back and forth inside the soap film and makes it thicker some places, thinner in others, and so that's shown on this in the top drawing. So the bottom drawing shows a similar bubble that you would make out of a smectic liquid crystal. So in OASIS, the letter S means smectic. So on the lower film, the thickness is always a number of molecular layers thick. So typically in the space experiment, the bubbles we're going to be making will be two molecular layers thick. So that corresponds to n equals 2 in that drawing. So that's kind of the solid part of the liquid crystal in this case. It wants to be in layers. But these layers are two-dimensional liquids. They flow just like an ordinary liquid. So if you make a bubble, then you can make it two layers thick. But some places it may have a different thickness. Some places it may be five layers thick. So these thicker places show up as circular disks, as they look like islands moving on the bubble. And I'll show you a video of that in a minute. OASIS is an experiment where we make these very thin quant films quantized in thickness, and then look at the physics of thicker parts, islands, on the surface of the bubble. Now, you may be familiar with the videos of the astronauts playing with water in space. They're really fantastic. And, you know, they just show you, you know, how different for a fluid microgravity can be than being on Earth. And you know, in our experiments, we have the same, you know, kind of, you know, the space station opens the same kind of possibilities. It just enables a whole different class of experiments. So we have a video of one of our bubbles. So this is a bubble. It's about 15 millimeters in diameter. This is actually a video taken in Cleveland that's in technology in the prototype, you know, in the experimental hardware at Glenn NASA Research. So you see the black areas of the bubble are 6 nanometer thick liquid films, two molecular layers thick, and then the little bright disks are the islands. These are the thicker layers. So we circulated the bubble with air, which is one of the experiments, and we created an emulsion of islands. And one of the experiments is to see how this emulsion evolves over time. Now you can see right now that this will run again in a second here. So in this video, the bottom of the bubble is actually the top of the display. Okay, so and you can see in the image that right at the top there are these thicker regions which are colored. So they have many smectic layers. Okay, so now we circulate the bubble. Once we stop, then you can immediately see that the colored regions, the thicker regions, start moving toward the top. So they're sedimenting to the bottom of the bubble. So we need the space station to eliminate this kind of sedimentation. Another important class of experiments are called exploring the thermocapillarity. So this is, we know that there are strong effects on fluids from buoyancy, that is gravity coupling to the density of the fluids. But temperature gradients also drive flow. So if you have a fluid that's warm in some places and cooler in others, there's an inherent tendency for the fluid to move, which buoyancy, which gravity effects strongly complicate the study of. So one class of experiments is to apply temperature gradients to these bubbles and watch the corresponding flow. If you try to do this kind of experiment on Earth, the gravity-driven convection makes it totally impossible. So we have quite a variety of different experiments directed toward understanding the basic science of this kind of system.
We have a question here.
Christian Kiske, NASA Social. With this research, are you testing specific hypotheses, or are you just looking at it and just seeing what happens?
Well, it's a combination of the two. I mean, since we've never done, we've never made this kind of, system. I mean, we're not even sure liquid crystals have ever been, experimented with in space. But so part of it will just be doing, we have a set sort of, we've sort of scripted the first 15 plays, if you will. We're going to do certain things and watch what happens. But then, for example, in the case of a thermocapillarity, there are theoretical predictions of what should happen, and, we'll do experiments to, directly to test those.
Mark Gotch, Historical Imagery Canada. Could you tell me, are there currently LCD screens in use in the ISS, and has zero microgravity, has it acted on them adversely thus far?
I think there are numerous liquid crystal displays on the ISS. And I don't think microgravity has been a problem for that technology, for the liquid crystal technology. The liquid crystal is in a gap, in a very narrow gap between solid plates, and it completely fills the space. So, the voltage induced changes that make the display, well, you could ask, is it a problem on Earth? Because they have very little density difference, and so they don't seem to be. It doesn't seem to be a problem.
Ken, you had a question.
Ken Kramer, America's Space Universe today. Can you talk a little bit about how these experiments are going to be done? Are they done remotely from the ground? Are the astronauts intervening? Are they running the experiment? And are you getting the data back in real time, or is it coming back at the end of the mission? Thanks.
Okay. Yeah, thanks for the questions. So the experiment that I showed on tape, for example, watching the bubble and then turning on an air jet and then watching what happens and then deciding what to do next, that will all be done from the ground. So the experiment consists of video imaging hardware and recording, and then you have to inflate a bubble. We're creating the bubbles in space, so that will also be done remotely from the ground. The bubble and its immediate hardware are contained in sort of small sealed chambers about that size. So these will be exchanged, installed, and there are four different separate samples to be looked at, so four different of these chambers. So these will be exchanged by the astronauts, but that will be their only, I think that's their only planned role. Then the image that you saw on the screen, that will be relayed down in real time. But you can see that it's, you know, the video quality is not that great. So, but these images will also be recorded on hard drives on the experiment, and then they'll be returned on SpaceX with the, you know, with a return flight. So that's also an element in this experiment. Be a lot of video data.
How often would the astronauts exchange the?
Maybe once every 2 or 3 weeks or something like that.
Okay, so let's move on to Dr. Pajevic, the Osteo4 investigation. Can you tell us a little bit about this investigation?
So the Osteo4 is an osteocyte mechanotransduction, and osteocytes, for the one of you that are not aware, are the most abundant cells in bone, and these are the cells deeply embedded within the mineral-like matrix of the bone. And the current view is that these are the cells that can sense the mechanical forces applied to the skeleton and then transform these mechanical forces into biological signal. So it is well known that during disuse, for example, during bed rest or paralysis, or during reduced loading, like in spaceflight, there is a substantial bone loss. And the current view is that osteocytes are indeed the cells within the bone that can sense the mechanical forces, or can sense the load, and then signal to the other bone cells, like osteoblasts or bone-forming cells or osteoclasts, to either make more bone or reduce bone. So the goal of the Osteo4 mission is actually to study osteocytes and the mechanism of mechanotransduction at the cellular level. So we will fly isolated osteocytes, and this will be the first time that osteocytes are flown in space. This project has been supported by a grant from NIH, has been supported by CASIS, and also by NASA, the Kennedy Space Center, and is part of the biomedical research on the International Space Station, or Biomed ISS, that is a collaborative project between NIH and NASA. And our goal is to really identify at the cellular level both the gene and proteins that are differentially regulated in microgravity, in an effort to then identify potential novel therapeutic that can be used both on Earth or in space to prevent bone loss, or either to try to rebuild bones once it's lost.
So can you talk a little bit more about how you'll grow the cells on orbit? I think you brought something
to
show us.
Yes. So we developed the cells that we've been flown in space, have been developed in my laboratory, and these are also said to have been isolated from a long bone of genetically modified animals, mice. We will grow cells in a three-dimensional scaffold, and then we will house scaffold in fully enclosed bioreactor that are like this one, for who is interested. And three of these bioreactors will be integrated into a fully automated fluid pathway that will provide not only the nutrients for the cells, but at a certain time during the mission will fix and preserve the cells. And we will have three pathways, so for a total of 9 bioreactors that will be terminated at different time during the flight. We will have astronauts remove this bioreactor after 3, 5, and 7 days of microgravity, and that will be stored at cold temperature, and that will be the sample, frozen sample, will be returned to our laboratory, and then we will study them once they are returned. And this was developed by Calm Technology, that is from Kingston, Ontario, in collaboration with the Canadian Space Agency. And this will be the fourth time that the Osteo is flying in space, and Osteo actually is for osteoporosis experiment in orbit.
Are there questions? Sir? Oh, right behind you.
Jim Siegel, I'm with the Celebration News and Spaceflight Insider. I'm particularly interested, Doctor, in the experiments that you described. And my understanding was that eventually, not overnight, of course, these experiments will benefit people who may have osteoporosis or other kinds of afflictions like that. And I wonder if you could explain a little bit about how this experiment fits in with the overall goal of helping people like that here on Earth. What other kinds of experiments need to be done? And also, how specifically does the results of this experiment help in furthering that knowledge?
So we are actually particularly interested in osteocytes and how these cells can sense unloading or reduced loading. So, for example, if you are a prolonged bed rest or a paralysis, it's known that you're losing bone rapidly. And we know that osteoclasts, they are the cells that reduce bone, are the ones that actually destroy your bone. But we still don't know what are the signals that go from osteocytes to osteoclasts. And we still don't know how actually osteocytes can sense there is a reduced loading applied to the skeleton. So our ultimate goal is if we can understand what are the genes and proteins that are regulated at the osteocytes by loading or unloading, we can then envision that we can, in situation like a paralysis or a spaceflight, almost trick the bone, trick the osteocytes to tell them you're still loaded while you're not, and then therefore not induce bone loss. And then it could also benefit people affected by osteoporosis. You can try to rebuild bone. But again, these are quite long-term project.
Is it this gentleman here?
Christian Kiske with NASA Social. All the experiments that I know of so far on the astronauts, of course, have been full-grown mature humans. Is there any plans for studying immature cells? Obviously, we're not going to send children into space, but perhaps do some experiments on bones that are still growing to see how that could compare.
Well, that's an excellent question. Of course, it would be very interesting to understand also not just what are the mechanism of bone loss, but also to see bone development of bone growth. But that's, I guess, will be down the line, experiment down the line.
There have been some investigations in the past looking at development of mice, pups, and they do have significant changes in the bone structure and also in their ability to sense gravity and right themselves. So they're severely impaired after being developmentally exposed to the microgravity environment.
And actually, if I can add, even the joint will be probably affected by microgravity. So not just bone, but also all the joint can be affected by lack of exposure to gravity during development or during growth.
Question here.
Mark Gotch, Historical Imagery Canada. Can you tell me, thus far, has human bone growth of human bone cells been very successful here on Earth? Would you expect that the growth that you're planning to do in the ISS would be far more, increasingly or quicker growth than is currently done on Earth, or is it being done here?
So actually, we are not expecting that there will be an accelerated growth of bone in microgravity, but we will really need to use the International Space Station to to test on the in a isolated osteocytes what are the effects of microgravity, because we do have some analog that we can use in the laboratory. So for example, NASA developed this slow rotating bioreactor that can mimic microgravity on Earth. But for us to really validate that the system that we have on Earth is really working, we really need to study osteocytes in microgravity. So the expectation is not that not the cells will grow faster in microgravity, but is really to see what are the direct effects of microgravity or reduced loading in osteocytes. And at the moment, we really don't have ideal ground-based model. And I think that the data that we will get back from this experiment will not just help us to understand osteocytes, but can be a really an important tool to really validate the system that we have in the lab.
Kent?
Yeah, Ken Kramer, Universe Today in America Space. It kind of a general question on this bone loss issue. I think the way the astronauts prevent bone loss right now is mainly through exercise. Is that right? Or is there any medicines they are taking? And is your research hopefully going to develop some pharmaceutical to minimize or prevent bone loss? Is that part of it at all? Thanks.
Well, you will correct me if I'm wrong. I think that some astronauts are on some osteoporosis treatment, and these, I think, they are bisphosphonate, if I'm not wrong. These are drugs that they will prevent bone loss, and they can work, but they all have side effects. They will work really well for astronauts or when you have a bone loss that you know is going to occur. What we are hoping also to identify is some therapeutics, some drug that will actually help you rebuild the bones once you have lost it, because that's the one that we are still currently, we don't have, because these are the drug that will benefit people affected by osteoporosis. So to go back to your question, there are some good treatment for prevent bone loss in astronaut, but I think that there is a still room for more.
That's correct. And the only thing I would add is that we've studied the bisphosphonates, but we haven't incorporated it into our normal medical operations is in terms of a countermeasure. So it mainly is based on the exercise programs.
I think I'd add to that that nutritional supplements such as vitamin D are also used in the astronaut program. And the bone loss problem in crew members to some extent has been ameliorated by the addition of a resistive exercise device on the space station known as the ARED. And so the resistive exercise device, vitamin D and also bisphosphonates, and under some studies have been shown to help the crew maintain their overall bone density over a 6-month mission. We don't know yet what happens in extended missions, and that's part of the 1-year spaceflight program that we're engaging in now to try and find out what happens.
Do we know anything from the four Russian astronauts about their bone loss beyond 6 months?
We do know some things about it, but they did not have the same controls that we have on station in terms of exercise devices, dietary controls, and so forth. So it's very hard to draw conclusions. Again, what we're looking for is how are we going to be able to maintain that bone mass as we go all the way from low Earth orbit to maybe Mars orbit. And to build that story, we need to know what kind of exercise devices we can take with us, what kind of dietary supplements, whether they exist or are sustained over long periods of time.
Great. Thank you all for joining us today. We will be back in about an hour at 3:30 p.m. Eastern Time to learn about a couple more investigations that will be conducted on the International Space Station and delivered with this mission with the launch tomorrow. And then at 5 p.m. Eastern, we'll have the pre-launch news conference. So you can follow along with our researchers, both in orbit and these studies online at nasa.gov/station, and find all the news related to the launch and the mission at nasa.gov/SpaceX. Thank you.